I'm a people painter and a cityscape painter. I did teach a couple, one in Provence, one in San Miguel de Allende in Mexico, one here in New York City. They were all about the figure. They were putting figures in your paintings, basically. That's what they were. We would hire models, or we would just catch people sitting, and we would even do things like paint our own reflections in storefronts to do self-portraits. It was great. I loved it. But I also have been hiring other people to teach for me for the plein air painting part of it. And I've been doing that for 25 years. So you guys, I looked at your website. I looked at everybody's work. I saw that you do, there's people are painting Bob Dylan and RBG. And I saw that one of you is doing that. And Jimi Hendrix, I like those. There were dancers and animals and landscapes and still lives. And so I had a good feel, and abstract, I had a good feel for what's going on. I think you have a great place. I looked at the facility online, and I'm jealous. I mean, it was really nice. And I, the fact that you have, that you can have life drawing there, when things open up again, is invaluable. It is incredible. Because my philosophy is, if you want to paint from photographs, which you have to do now these days, if you want to get anything done, you really need the experience of painting from life, because that gives you, that just gives you the foundation to take a photograph and put life into it. That's how I've been feeling for years. And I've been working on trying to do that myself for that amount of years. The important things, I'm just wrote some notes here. I feel, I will show you in a second here. Whatever weakness I had, I wanted to work on those weaknesses. And once it was drawing, so I really spent a lot, many, many hours in drawing class. Then it was composition. I would take a sketchbook to the museum in Paris, the d'Orsay. I'd go to the Impressionist wing, and I would sketch out really fast all of the compositions in these paintings to learn what they were doing. I read books on compositions. The big thing for me was color. And I studied color Hopper. I forget the name of the painting. But I love Hopper. I've been to a number of his shows. Padma, I know, he's told me she's been to one of his shows down in DC. I saw a show of his in the city a long, long time ago. And I also saw shows of his actually in outside Paris, in Giverny, where there used to be an American Impressionist museum up there. And he did a lot of work. He did a lot of plein air work in the old days in Paris. And I love that. So Hopper, so what was I gonna say about Hopper? Anyway, so Hopper, of course, was a New York painter. The thing I really like about him was his figures were not pretty. A lot of times it was just his wife. That was the Joe, her name was, who was the model for most of the women in his paintings. And in one case, Joe actually modeled for Robert Henri, who was a major figure in the Ashton School years ago. He did a fantastic painting of her holding paintbrush. She was a painter too, as well. Kind of gave up her career more or less to support him. So what my philosophy is, and before I start, I want to show you some tools I use. That this is what I discovered a year ago. You know what this is? It's a compass, or a protractor. Well, I don't know what a compass or protractor. I think it's a compass, right?
Yes.
What you do is, especially with the figure, no matter how many years I've been painting the figure, how many thousands of figures I painted, it's so easy to make mistakes and have this wrong or that. Oh, this isn't right. Well, that's not right. And that's why it always takes so much going back and redoing. And if I don't like it, rub it out and start again. And don't keep going if it's not right. That's the thing I've learned. But this, so you take, if you really want to do a measurement, and sometimes to help use this, but sometimes I do, I'll show you what I'm doing now. I might take this, measure ahead, and then from there, I'll say, okay, the next one down is by her elbow. The next one down is by the bottom of her leg. So I use this as a measuring device. And it's really helped when I get stuck in a figure, because I like to do all my paintings have figures in them. So I like to get those right. Okay, so I don't know, politically, we're not talking about politics today, of course, but I did a whole series of political paintings that you can see on my website. I don't want to talk about them now, but we're not getting into that. Okay. So here's a blank canvas, and what I like to do is just really loosely. We got some morning dogs outside trying to get in. Sorry, you guys can't come in. All right. So what I would do is I'd mix, put a little, we all have our habits, how we start stuff. I like to start with a little yellow and violet and make a kind of a light wash with them. And then I'll take this. You're good. You can see from here. It's nice. It'll work. And so I'll just try to really loosely just put stuff kind of like where she is, just to start, just to get her started here. And then just draw some of the lines where I see things going on. What you notice what he did here, which is, of course, he took this, the light part, you can see that, right? Mm-hmm. And he put it in against the shadow part of her, so it stands out. And then the dark part is up against the light side of her, making that stand out. That's a common thing we do as painters. I mean, I think we've all done that. And this is really good example of it. One thing I've noticed about some of his paintings, I saw a show of his in New York years ago, and I walked in, it wasn't this painting, it was a woman on a bed, and I looked at it and said, if that woman lied down in that bed, she'd be about 6 feet too long. And I said, well, how did he get away with that? And artists get away with stuff. I mean, I saw a Rembrandt painting in Amsterdam last year, the year before, on a workshop I was doing. And it was one you've probably seen, the surgery on the guy's arm. I think not a surgery, it was in the morgue, that kind of a thing. And I looked at it. Well, one arm was longer than the other. And no one notices those things. I notice them. They don't bother me. They just kind of, they show me that an artist is not limited by, we can get away with stuff. I mean, if you're painting the figure, though, unlike a landscape or a still life, you can't put the eyes in the wrong place unless you're Picasso or that kind of thing. But, you kind of have to make sure those things are right. So I do a lot of measurement with this, measure this one head, that kind of thing. So here I would go back here. She's kind of in the middle. I'd say, well, where is she in this canvas? I'll go like this. The middle of her head is here. So she's further back from the middle. Here's the middle. The middle of the canvas is more like, the middle of the canvas is kind of like the front of her face. This would be kind of like the middle of the canvas here. Front of her face is here, so I'll just kind of put that in loosely. Then neck goes down here, and the arm. I always try to see. Okay, so like I put the. Can you see this here?
Yes.
This down the forehead, and say, okay, what's down there? This is incredible. This is such a valuable tool. I mean, anatomy for draftsmanship. And I mean, I took anatomy classes where you build the whole figure with clay, muscle, one muscle at a time, and you don't need that. It's all observation. I mean, it didn't hurt, but it still comes down to observation. So I will drop the paintbrush down from her forehead to see where it intersects the other parts of her body, and that'll show me where those parts go. Anyway, this it's going to be really loose now. Down here, this is too far over, and then the legs will come down here. Let me put some more color there. All right, so again, here's basically the front of the face, the hair coming back. And you know, if I decide at any point that this is wrong, I have to just, I'll erase it and just do it over. Because I, it's one thing I can't deal with. If it's wrong, I can't accept that and go on. So here's the shoulder coming back behind, from behind. Neck. I mean, it's good to know that their muscles is a deltoid muscle. Here's a, I mean, that's the anatomy has helped in that way. And sometimes I'll just go something like really simple. I'll go, okay, forehead, hand. I look at this. I won't even look at this. I'll look at this. I'll go, forehead, hands about over here. Okay, then. And then where is that? I'll drop this down again and see the front of her face goes down just by her elbow. So her elbow's got to be down here, basically, and come back up and here. And then this. Sometimes I'll just color in where, you know, where it's kind of darker. Then this comes back out. Angle like this down here. The shirt that she's wearing. Really loose. Later on, to me, the painting is always a process of going back and redoing, going back over and over again and redoing. I happen to like outlines a lot, and sometimes I'll use them really strongly in a painting. Sometimes I won't. I mean, Van Gogh did that, and of course, he's an artist I love. So, and then I look at little things. Okay. Here's her butt. Now, where does that come in? Where the leg starts to go up is by her ear. So, here's her ear. Drop down line. So here's where the butt starts going up, the leg starts going up this way, and hopefully it comes out to the right place. But then it has to be the same level. I mean, it's well, not quite yet. I'll line up the bottom of her tush. All right, so here's. Is that, and I'm just putting in these other lines. This is a very abstract painting. I mean, really, this big shape here, these shapes, this, and she herself is you know, the figure is always the hardest. One of the things I learned, what I do, is I always keep, as I progress in the painting, the figure is always one step ahead of everything else. And within the figure, the head is always one step forward, ahead of the rest of the figure. That's kind of how I learned it, and I pretty much do it that way. As you can see, her chin is too high up here. Here's her shoulder. Chin's about over here. So I definitely had it too far up. I'm not worried about the thing, her face yet. But what I like to do, is I don't paint with a lot of brushes. Sometimes I'll do a painting with two or three brushes and just keep cleaning them. I don't know why. I think because I don't like cleaning 16 brushes when I'm done. So because this whole area is dark, what I'll do is I'll just take this brush and really loosely, even a little paint thinner. I want to cover the canvas fairly soon with thin paint thinned out with paint thinner. kind of give me an idea, just to kind of set the stage more or less. I'll go back into that later. I'm not concerned about what color it is now, or any of that. Then I will do maybe a little more drawing on her. Let's see. And here's a good, I would take this brush and put it under her leg like this to get the angle. This is the angle of a leg. Then I'll come here and I'll go, okay, angle's not quite right. And because that's orange, I might, you know, I have my own way of doing things. So I might take some orange here. Dirty orange. Just to set that up, and I would, again, I'm not too worried about the drawing yet, because all that's going to be developed as I go along. But I still might try to outline her face just a little bit, give me something to work with here. And the hair is usually the dark hair. It's usually the darkest thing in the painting, can be. So I'd like to get that in first, the hair. I mixed some burnt sienna with some phthalo blue just to get a darker color. No, actually, was that phthalo green I did anyway. All right, so that as I keep doing this, I will go back and reestablish some drawing stuff. Then I might, my way of doing things, I have paper towels and I have a rag. So I wipe that off there into the paint thinner, then I wipe that off in the rag. Again, everyone has their own crazy things they do. So I'm going to put the shadow side. I want to stay with the figure right now. So I'm going to put the shadow side into a figure. One of my favorite combinations is red and green for the cool part, for the shadow part of the figure. And that could be sometimes orange and green, red, I mean, different mixtures of each one until I get one I feel I like. That I try that and see what happens. And let's see. So here, even though this is, if you look at this painting pretty carefully, it's that light in her shoulder is blue. I don't like that. It looks almost like a tattoo color. I'm not crazy about that. Anyway, but I won't tell him. So I'll just really maybe brush that in loosely here. I don't want it to be the same color as what's behind it, but I'm changing that anyway. I'm not too concerned with getting everything exactly right just yet. And then I might indicate some light on her, because I do want to get her first, establish her, then work around her. So, I would, when I'm doing this, I would use the colors that I want to use, not always the color that he's going to use. I do to some degree, but I also want to keep it what I want. So again, I just get it really loosely in there. And there's some really strong red in her face there. I mean, he really pushed that red. Then I would kind of reestablish some drawing again, which I always like to do, maybe with a smaller brush. And I like to take some strong color and do that so I can see what's going on. So now I'm seeing a mistake with this. Her hand's got to come. Her hand, the way her hand is sitting on her leg here, I've got that wrong. I've got it too high up over here. Sometimes, and I'll use the brush this way too. I'll go across here and say, well, the bottom of her wrist is intersecting this place below her breast, and that's the, you draw the line, so that would be way, so I've got this way off. So that's okay, that happens. So I will scrape that off here, because I want this to be right. The great thing about oil painting is you scrape stuff off and it doesn't hurt. I like that. That's where the hand is going to be. Eventually. All right. So then I will take a bigger brush and just put in the background there. Looks like he has some, I see some blue in there, I see some yellow, some violet. So I'll just figure out what to do myself. Violet, yellow, thinking about complementary colors and also how it's important to match the light with the shadow in terms of it's gotta be some of the color from the light in the shadow and some of the color from the shadow into the light. Again, just a wash, just a thin wash. This I could change later. I want to add more violet because I happen to like violet. Some canvases are better than others in terms of you don't need that much to cover the canvas. I definitely like a portrait grade. I don't have it here, but I like a portrait grade even when I'm painting this because the paint just stays on the surface and it's so easy to cover the white canvas. So this just takes a little more time. I'll thin it out a little more. I keep dipping my brush in paint thinner. with this kind of canvas, once I get the thin layer down, then the next one on top of it will be easier. Just a little more. Then I'll get the blue on the side of her bed there. Looks like there's some red also in that blue. Of course, you can do anything you want. You don't have to stick to the colors. That'll come back this way. Then the shadow under her, also on the bed, that's important, of course. The shadow under her leg, you know, these shadows here, here and here. Just treat them as a shape. Don't even have to look at them as shadows. They're just shaped to be. And what I'm trying to do is now cover the canvas. Oh, I'm glad that stopped. Then I will do maybe a little drawing over here. The figure's starting to look halfway decent. I'll have to see again what changes I have to make at later on as I go through it. Because there always are adjustments to the figure. When you're painting the figure, tons of adjustments, and that's okay. So this comes from. Just drawing here. Corner of the room. This, you know, if you're painting cityscapes and stuff, this again is a great tool in terms of perspective. So like in this building back here, I would line this up like this. This up like this to see what the real angles are. All that, this angle up here, I use the brush to line it up. Then I go to the canvas and see, oh, that's where that goes. That's been an incredible help. Somebody showed me that in Denver like about 35 years ago. And there's a whole bunch of stuff going on here. We don't have to go through all of that right now, but that's where the end of the brick will be. And then the building will be over. And like over here, stuff going on up there. So I'll put that dark also. Here. we're going to have to make corrections to that hand. And I'm pretty sure of that. I don't mind. I don't care. And I will absolutely do it. So that might put the light in actually behind her. If I'm happy with that. Let's see here. I'm gonna look at the back of her, whatever that is. What do you call that? A house dress? I don't know. I would mix some orange with a little violet in this case. Maybe a touch of green. Darken it, thin it out. As long as I'm working on that, I would probably put the light in on that garment of hers, for want of a better word. I don't know what it is. Some up here. It's going to have to be lighter than that, brighter and lighter. And he's got red in there too. It's really interesting to be working with somebody's painter like him, because you really can get to see, well, here's the shadow, and here's the light, and there's a strong color right in between them, which he has up here as well. Doesn't have it quite so much here, but he does have touches of warmer color in the skin, different places. Anyway, so this, for that, we'll... look then at doing something, the light in the background. I like to work with a glass palette. So I take my razor knife and it makes it so easy to clean. That's why I like oils. What I don't like about them is how messy they are. I always get yelled at for something like some phthalo blue I leave somewhere in the house. But that's the price. You live with a painter? Come on. All right. So this definitely is green. So I should probably have some more green back here in my painting, which I will do. Anyway, I would take something that looks similar. I'm using a little phthalo green. But I also see some, I see some red in there. I see some yellow in there. Anyway, I'm going to put this in and see what it looks like. Again, it takes a while to cover that canvas. outline her a little bit. Now, you know, for me, I would put then, I would go back into that dark behind her and actually try to put some more green in there myself. I mean, that's not too much, maybe. I think that's too green, which I do, I'd probably rub that out. Or what I would do is just tone that down a little bit. Anyway, moving right along. You know, I want to go back into her. I don't want to avoid the hard part here, which is getting this leg right. But first, you know what? I'm going to put the light on the bed. Can you still hear? You can? Okay. Everyone's so quiet there. What's going on? Did I put you to sleep? What happened?
Watching you with avid interest, Phil.
Okay. Let me clean this palette. Whoa. Uh-oh. I go through so many paper towels that I always ask the forest to forgive me for doing that to their trees. Very sensitive about that, you know. Okay, so now clean this brush off a little bit. I haven't changed this is a terpenoid, of course. I haven't changed it in a week, and still it could be clean. It's amazing. Okay, so the bed, it's white, of course, a little yellow in it. There's some shades, this yellow over here, it's white and yellow, so shades of blue, maybe violet over here. Anyway, and then a little bit of half shadow over here. But I'm going to just put maybe just a tiny touch of blue in it. With some, maybe a tiny touch of orange, just to give me something here. Oh, what did I do? Okay. Just see what happens here. Oh, a little dirty. Let's see. This might be too dirty. I don't know. Now this is where I could shape, let's see. before I put, I want to put some blue back here, some white back here, but I have this shadow. Well, actually, the shadow does belong there. But I want, what I would probably do to make room for this, to make room for this light here, and right now I have all shadow there, I would probably, I will take my rag, my trusty rag, and just wipe off that area that I want to have the light on. So, now I made room for the light. So now I can put that in. I'll have to reestablish this shadow be back here, because that's not right anymore. It's actually starting to take shape. It's starting to look like supposed to. Definitely work on the figure now. And it's up to 47 degrees in here, kind of like summertime. Okay, figure, what do we got? So, I'll start with the head. I'll get some of the hair in, get some of the hair in first, on the top of her head. So, some light hitting on the top of her head there, the hair. Sometimes I might even just, well, I want to do some more drawing here, so I might. Reestablish with what I. now for the head, I might kind of indicate where the eye is. Now I'll put some color in her head. Forehead looks a little kind of like a cool. It's, I know it's in the light, but you know, sometimes it's cool color in the light. I might have some just with a little blue and orange or some way up here. I am going to darken her shirt a little more violet, and again, a touch of green maybe. See what that is. to reestablish the darks on her skin. Is everyone still hanging in there? Okay. If you all leave, you gotta let me know. I don't want to be painting here by myself. Of course, when I'm done, I'm gonna stay in here. I'm working on another Hopper painting. Actually, this one.
Wow. Oh, wow.
So I got to work. I got a lot of work to do. Mm. That was rubbed out twice already because I just was not happy with some stuff. Okay. Probably not going to be able to do everything here while you guys are around. You probably have, I don't know, you have other things to do or whatever. But anyway, let's see what we can do. I painted the microphone. How about that? Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I would probably cut back a little bit on this leg here. This is where I don't mind using outlines, which I'll erase later, but and for me, it's just reestablishing the figure. This hand is really awkward in here. So I'm not going to be drawing all of it right now.
Well, Jenny had a question.
Yeah.
She said, hold on, let me, her audio is not. She wanted to ask about the oils from the first painting smearing into the final painting.
The oils from the first painting?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Like the, I think the layer below it, right?
The what?
You know, the first, you first did a, like a draft, right?
Oh yeah, right.
And then that color would come into the next layer, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm.
Yeah, I just try to draw it in very loosely, mm-hmm. and then kind of put some color in really thin to cover the big areas. Just feel through it, to okay. feel through it mm-hmm. until it feels right. Well, looks right. Okay, we could probably, if you're still hanging around, we could do some more. We could go into this area here if you want. Well, this is fun. I enjoyed this, and let me see. Problem I see that I'm going to correct after we get off the air. From the chin to the shoulder, I have too much distance. It's more like this. Anyway. So there, okay. Hey, thanks, ladies.